Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Patty Beese with the National Restaurant Association. Welcome to today's presentation, Women Leaders on Pandemic Lessons Learned and Post-Pandemic Plans. Before we begin, I'd like to go over a few housekeeping items. Everyone's audio is muted and your video is turned off. So if you have any questions, please go ahead and enter them in the Q&A box. We'll try to get to as many questions as possible. However, if we run into time constraints, we may not get to them all, so we appreciate your understanding. Lastly, this presentation is being recorded and will be distributed afterwards. And I don't know, give us about a week, give or take, to get that out to you. So bear with me here. I need to do a little bit of legal now. With all our meetings, we will comply with all antitrust law requirements. Please refer to the slide on the screen. Oh, my apologies, it's not in presentation mode. As always, we should avoid disclosing any confidential and competitively sensitive materials that you have not shared publicly already, especially regarding pricing, costs, or any other similar matters. I'd now like to turn things over to Emily Williams-Knight to introduce the other ladies and to kick off the conversation.
Great, thank you. Hi everyone, thank you so much for joining us today. I can tell you it's a real honor to have this group together. I feel it's such a privilege to be able to speak with them, and we had an opportunity to meet beforehand, and I think you're gonna get some great insights today. I'm actually just gonna do a quick intro of each and their affiliation, and then I'm gonna turn it over to them and sort of start with their little bit of their journey they can share on the sector, how they reached this, you know, some of the highest levels that you can, and then also where they started, because I think we don't often go back and reflect on, none of us started in CEO roles or executive roles and sort of what that journey was like. And so with me today, I have Karen Stutz, who is the president and CEO of Native Foods. I have Amy Horn, who is the vice president of operations at Sweetgreen, and Meg Rose, who is the SVP of field operations at Firehouse Subs. So thank you, ladies, so much for being here. And Karen, I'm going to start with you. Just a little bit more about yourself.
Well, thank you, Emily. And first of all, just say, it's Amy Hom. I don't always.
Oh, sorry, Hom. Sorry.
I know you knew that, but I just thought I'd point that
out. Sorry, Amy. Amy Hom.
No, all good. Happens a lot.
Actually, it's my maiden name, so I like to think that
we're. Oh, awesome. Awesome. I got it. And I even have Hom written down. Yeah.
There we go. Hey, I'm Karen Stutz, as Emily pointed out. Emily and I have gotten to know each other actually through National the Pro Start. We were fellow judges for probably 7 years judging the management competitions. And wow, what a great organization. Still a huge fan there. So that's how I know Emily. I have been in the industry, I guess I would easily say this is my fifth decade. I've been in the food service industry forever. You ask about our first job. My first job was McDonald's. They came to our high school and recruited the cheerleading team. And so we all were like, wow, okay, let's go do it. And honestly, I fell in love with the industry then and never looked back. So I've been doing it to kind of give you some perspective. We were one of the test restaurants for the Egg McMuffin. So that might date me a little bit, but I still love that product today. So a lot of fun.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I've been blessed to be in the industry for, like I said, quite a long time. I've done time in, quick service, casual dining, and fast casual. If you kind of watch my career, I followed the growth. It's always fun to be in an organization and a segment of the industry that's growing. I still believe there's growth in fast casual right now. And that's why I'm here. And actually, I just love the fact that we have a little bit more of the better for you type of food as well. And I think that's one thing we've all learned through the pandemic about, you know, self-care and feeding our souls and really taking good care of yourself. So again, a very fun segment to be in. But yes, so that's where I am at Native Foods, 100% plant-based restaurant. We're in 4 states, and that's me. So I'll turn it over to back to you, Emily.
Excellent, thank you. Meg, let's go to you next.
Yep, so my name is Meg Rose. I'm Senior Vice President for Field Operations at Firehouse Subs. And it's such, I always reflect on what a small world the restaurant industry is. I met Emily the same way at ProStart, which again is an amazing organization. But I met many years ago, I don't want to date myself quite that much, but I was in college and lost my work study job. So I found a job as a waitress. First time I'd ever done that at an Italian restaurant doing breakfast. So a lot of fun, but kind of learned that and then ended up being a bartender, which is so cool. Love bartending. You really learn a lot about people. And then started, you know, got offered a job as a manager at Fridays back when Fridays was Fridays. Yes. You know, with the fun tossing of the drinks and the whole bit. And just kept on in the industry. In fact, worked for many years for an Applebee's franchisee at the same time that Karen was involved with Applebee's International. So again, that small world. And then have spent the last 14 years with Firehouse, which is just an amazing, amazing organization. And watched that grow. We're now in, we have over 1,200 restaurants where it's easier to list the states we're not in than that we are, and also have locations in Canada as well as Puerto Rico. But I get to oversee operations, and it's exciting. So anyway, I'm glad to be here today. So back to Emily.
Yeah, that's incredible. It's running ops for all that, right? That's a task in itself. Maybe we'll talk about in a little bit. Amy Hom.
Thank you, Emily. First off, thanks for having me. I am Amy Hom with Sweetgreen, servant leader to operations. We've got about 130 locations and growing, about one a week, so rapid growth. Started off not when they rolled out the Egg McMuffin, Karen, but did McDonald's and Burger King, AM shifts at McDonald's, PM shifts at Burger King, loved every minute of it. And I just have to give a shout out, lots of mentors along the way. I would not even be on this panel if it wasn't for advocates and sponsors and mentors with ladies like Karen Stutz and also my current leader, Chris Carr, big supporters. So, you know, you start in this business and you feel like you go to a party every day and you get to impact that. And then you get to watch people's growth and the passion for what we do. And I couldn't agree more, Meg. I think it's a small but mighty restaurant group that we're all connecting in, and it happened even more during COVID. I don't think we've been tighter. So really appreciate the time.
Yeah, excellent. And I'll just add that my first role out of college was Pizza Hut management training program, but it was when we launched the stuffed crust. And I can tell you that maybe why I'm no longer, it was a ton of work and so successful. And I saw how quick these companies moved. And like you just said, Amy, it's a party every day, which is why my whole career has been built around the sector is it's the people, right, that attract us, not just the customers, but who we work with. And so I'm going to take us back just for a second. And I know it's probably not somewhere we want to go back to naturally. And that's really this pandemic period. You know, I know we can all close our eyes and remember where we were when we knew our lives were going to change. I was on a beach in Cabo, believe it or not, trying to get home when the governor's office called in Texas to say restaurants were closing across the whole state. And we had 34% of our restaurants able to even make a dollar the next morning, right? Because they had delivery or carry out. As you think about your businesses, and I'm going to start with Meg, what are some of the key lessons that you learned during that period about your business, right? And then maybe one or two that you're going to continue, because I think that's what gets lost in this was it wasn't all bad. There was tremendous innovation that maybe we can carry forward. So maybe just share some of those eye-opening moments from that period and what you want to take with you.
Sure. And goodness, there was a lot of them, you know, just that sheer shock of, you know, we always talk with our franchisees that you always want to save for a rainy day. And then all of a sudden that rainy day had a name, and that was the pandemic. And man, it was, so I think one of and had great leadership. We had great leadership at our company. And one of the first things that had to be done is to make the decisions that were going to get us through that surviving, not only surviving, but thriving. Really had the decisions had to be made that the people sitting at the table were the ones that had the ability to make decisions quickly, think through every aspect or every possibility and arrive at what the solution was going to be quickly. It was no longer, you know, leading by committee. It was the people in the room that could do it, make the hard decisions and do it and carry it out. And so that meant there were people left out. People that are extremely important to the organization, but at that time, that wasn't their place. So kind of working through that and understanding one, you've got to be able to do that. You've got to have the leadership that has that ability to stand back and go, okay, who are those people that I need? What is our goal? And our goal at that point was we were going to keep as many restaurants open as possible. Mm-hmm. And if that meant changing hours, if it meant limiting menus, if it meant doing things that we never in a million years thought we would have done, that's what we were going to do. And fortunately, we were successful. I think we closed 22 restaurants, of which 17 have reopened. So, I mean, it was an amazing thing, but it was really, it's such a daunting thing when you look at and understand that you are holding the livelihood of all those franchisees who have put their life savings into this business, and that the decisions you're making, what those long-term impacts can be. So the first main thing was, okay, figure out what really is critical to your business and what you can let go of now. You know, as we put it, there are no sacred cows. And we've done things, you know, our hot sauce bars that we were have always been known for. Well, they went because that was a contact point. You know, hey, it's been great, but, you know, off they go. So that was, again, one of the biggest things. There are no sacred cows sometimes when you're looking at saving your business. But I think the other thing that I think was even more critical was we're a people business. You know, the restaurant, it's a people business. Your guests, your employees is a people business. And the impact on people, I don't think we'll ever know the true measure of that for years. So understanding, I have a lot of team that's remote, and all of a sudden now everybody's remote. You're at your homes, you're dealing with all those different things. That it was even more critical to figure out how do you make those contact points. So as much as Zoom and Google and all those other things can be, oh my God, I gotta, you know, make sure I'm dressed, I gotta make sure there's nothing in the background, that one-on-one contact also I think did a lot to get us through successfully. And that's one thing I'll take forward, that I don't care when we go back to the whatever our new normal is, my virtual calls that I do with my team, I'll continue to do those, because that was I probably spent more time with them than I ever did. But I think understanding you have to reach out to those people, just because they're putting on a happy face doesn't mean that they're not all dealing with so many different aspects from the pandemic. So.
Definitely. And I think even today we're all in different locations and we show our homes and we've seen our children or pets walk through. And I think we've humanized a little bit of work. Yep. And that maybe we are all even more comfortable seeing that we are normal in our situation, because everyone's just trying to get it done. So it's a great point. Amy, how about you? Anything to share, especially as your brand is growing so quickly, as this pandemic was obviously hitting the ground here for the last 15 months?
I piggyback on what Meg said. I think everybody moved quickly and we had to be nimble and we had to be very innovative. One of the things I know I've talked about before is just the outposts that we did with the hospitals and trying to help out the frontline workers. But at the same time, to your point, Emily, it's all about the people and making connects. So it was really amplifying moments of gratitude and making sure that we understand the challenges they're having in the business. What was really important for us at Sweetgreen is that we put the stores at the center of the universe, which I think most of you do already. And we revisit our leadership principles and to make sure that we're obsessing over the team member experience at all times. And so it's still a journey. I think we're in a phase of the pandemic. I don't think it's over. I know everybody's having staffing shortages and everybody's trying to solve for that. We're working together through that. But the resiliency that the teams show and just that humans can show when they actually are working together, and we'd have Zoom calls like Meg and it'd be beach day and I'd send a beach bag to their house and we'd just try to let loose for a minute because the tensions are high at home. The work structure changed. And it was really, really important that they knew that we were all there for them just as much as they are there for us. And so it's a fast moving train, right? I mean, between how to innovate quickly, how to keep the team safe, and how to connect with people like you all are on the call. It's important.
That's right. And I think you mentioned something earlier that I've never seen greater collaboration across the sector, competitors working together, competitors coming together to solve crises like hospitals and feeding first responders. And I think that's what I hope we carry forward, is that ability to still compete, but collaborate, right? When times, especially when times are tough. Karen, how about you? Because it's another, I mean, you've got a great brand and you're expanding as well. And, you know, as you think about that last year, what are some of those lessons that would be helpful for others? And maybe what you're going to take with you forward?
Yeah, look, I'm going to echo exactly the same thing that Meg and Amy said as well. First of all, it's about the people and those that stuck with us throughout this. You know, how would we have ever done this without them? Incredibly grateful for the team that stood by, came to work every day, really not knowing what the risks were, right? I mean, that was such an unknown right from the beginning. So incredibly grateful. And as Amy and I were talking earlier today about, you know, as we're starting to move forward to the pandemic, we're seeing people come back to work right now. I think, you know, there's a little bit of hope that there was going to be more workforce, you know, to help the individuals and kind of balance out that workload, which isn't quite there right now. And so, you know, you're starting to hear words like exhaustion, you know, burnout and those type of things. And so, you know, how we communicate and how we're transparent and how we talk with our team members and show appreciation are all incredibly important. I would also say, you know, a couple of the positives. We are the most generous industry ever. Incredible. No matter how bad any of us were hurting, we found a way to help others, right? And to feed others. And that will always be part of the hospitality industry. You talked about networking, right? And Emily, as far as whether competitors are coming together, I've only worked for big brands, right? Brinker, Applebee's, Red Robin, McAllister's, Wendy's, and, you know, first job at McDonald's. I'm working for a very, very small company that's just poised to grow with a team of seven. And having really minimal resources, this industry was a lifeline for me. You know, we're all part of this Fast Casual Industry Council that's, you know, an advisory group with the National Restaurant Association. Honestly, big companies, whether it was Chipotle or Wowbow or Larry Reinstein or all those folks, it didn't matter what you put a question out, everybody jumped in and answered. You know, Carl from Fazoli, just so many great individuals that were there for us all along. So our peer group, I don't even look at them as competitors, or friends, colleagues, peers, we're all in this industry together. And one other thing I think, you know, that lessons learned too, and I think we all heard about this at one time when Danny Meyer kind of stopped tipping and was really starting to call out the disparity between front of the house and heart of the house or back of the house kitchen workers. And I tried to look at this time as a time to reset that because service was absent like we knew it before, right? So everything, I mean, basically from March, and I'm only in states where everything was shut down for all of 2020. And I'm also in states where there's, you know, higher wages. I'm not in any type of tip credit states. So we were, yeah, in every management call, we talked about, here's the average wage for front of house, here's the average wage for back of house. And we really started calling that out and we started, you know, tip share. And we got information from other people from the fast casual industry. I think that's one of the things too, as we look forward to the industry and what I'm gonna carry forward is making sure that the back of the house team members, you know, feel that they're treated and paid equally compared to some of the our front of house as well.
Yeah, and I think, you know, and that'll take me kind of my next question, but we're all talking about it. If I don't get five, I get 10 interview requests a day to talk about the labor crisis. You know, I'll tell you my position is that people are just not inherently lazy and want to stay home, right? And that's sort of a narrative that's gotten out there. I think that many people are just making a rational choice for their family and they're putting all of the pieces on the table and that's the choice they're making. And so, I think it's a really complex problem, but obviously as operators and leaders, I would love to get your take on, you know, I could give you my answer, I think, but I would love your understanding because this really is, you know, we know on the ground with our restaurants that are reporting they're having to close early or close one day a week or, you know, have a limited menu. There's just a lot of reshaping of business right now because we don't have the level of employees that we need. And so I just would love sort of what's your take on that, right? And then do you see a solve for it? And maybe start with you, Meg.
Yeah, you know, we own 38 restaurants ourselves. So we have that same issue of dealing with labor and attracting folks. we took a very, very hard look at it about 2 months ago and said, look, we need to raise what we're paying people. Point blank, we need to raise what our minimum is going to be. Now, we're also in a state that's looking at some increases over, Florida's going up $5 over the next 5 years. So figure we could also jump, get a little bit of a jump ahead on that. But so we took a hard look, we raised our minimum wage that we were paying of every single employee in our restaurant, in our Florida restaurants, up to $12 an hour. Anybody making under that, or I'm sorry, anybody previously making over that, we gave an increase of, I think, 75 cents an hour. So everybody got a raise. And we did some other things with some benefits. One of the main thing is we just didn't want to be, we wanted to be able to put proudly on a sign what we were paying people, and saying I'm starting at minimum wage or I'm starting at $10 just wasn't enough to get people back. Fortunately, we have an easy system to do. We have good hours. We close at 9. It's great if you're a parent with kids in high school, but we still needed to make sure that we've been being fair and equitable with it. And at the same time, you know, we're a business. We took a real hard look at our pricing and took menu increases on that. And then we took that message out to our franchisees. And part of that message is like, look, sometimes you got to, it's not about how much money you make. If you want to make more, you got to take care of your people. And you need to take a hard look at that and go. And we had a franchisee, one of our largest ones, that say, hey, you know, you're right. I was embarrassed to tell people what I started my crew members at. And he has now changed and is able to attract more people. We had folks coming back in Jacksonville saying, hey, I hear what you're paying now and I want to kind of jump on board. So we have to take that hard business look and go, look, it's not always about our bottom line. It's going to be about their bottom line as well. And then we knew our managers were working a lot of hours. And so for a 4 week period, we actually put in a stipend that if they worked an extra shift, we were paying them an extra, I think it was $125 a shift, in addition to their salary, because hey, if we were going to, they were going to be that to that fatigue or that exhausted, at least they were going to have a little bit more money in their bank account to help with that. And that went a long way as well. But we had to take a really hard look at it and then still understand that there are factors. And it's not people are lazy and don't want to work. There are realistic factors on, you know, someone's got to stay home with the kids. Yeah. It was a two family paycheck before. Now it's down to one until school goes back in. There's still people, you know, the stats say 40% of the population are still afraid to go out. Mm-hmm. So we may be seeing all the folks who aren't afraid to go out in huge droves out there, but there's just as many folks who are concerned about their health. So there's a lot of reasons, but part of it, you've got to look inside. You've got to say, am I really paying fair and equitable wages to my employees? And that was what we did. And we've seen some success with it.
I love that. I'm assuming the response was very strong. And like you said, you have to take a hard look inside first at anything that's contributing, right? Versus just external factors. Mm-hmm. Haimi, how about you? I mean, this is around here, my daughters seem to be the most sought after right now because they're 15 in many locations and I want them to go work in a restaurant, right? To feel that. How about your brand? Talk a little bit about the staffing challenge.
It's the same as Meg, and I'm sure Karen's going through the same thing, right? The labor force is challenging right now. We are going to come out of it. And we, you know, we took a couple strategies that we really dug deep on. We put together a hiring task force. We refocused on our 90-day retention plan, and also we refocused and rebuilt our team structure within our four walls of each restaurant. So you can become a dishwasher and move into a head coach, aka GM, role in, you know, 3 years and, you know, make six figures. And so I think that there's so much opportunity in this industry, and there are a lot of companies that are really focused on doing that and making sure that the opportunity is there. And one of the things we've really been talking about also is having a more diverse workforce. So the diversity, the, you know, the equity, the inclusion, all of that, and making sure that we're doing it right as we are now bringing a lot of our folks back. But, you know, Sweetgreen's, we really focus on contributing to the community. A lot of the young folks want to work for a company that has a lot of purpose. and passion. And so, and aligns with their values. And so really talking about that as we interview people and making sure that they're a great fit and we're a great fit for them and it's a good partnership and joining the family, you know? So there's a lot going on. We're all trying to do a lot of different things, but it is really about growth and opportunity for us and also our mission and purpose.
Yeah. And it's feeling that connection. People want to feel like they belong mm-hmm. and that they're where they work cares about them as a person, right? Not just what they contribute at work. And we're seeing that come out in a lot of new research in this last couple of months about what's going to make people stay. And I think the thing that is unmeasurable right now is that psychological tale of this pandemic, which is, I think people had an opportunity to really be thoughtful about their life and how they spend their time, talent, and treasure. And so whether they're a doctor or a lawyer or working at a restaurant, people are making that reflection. And so the more that we can as an industry, not only display that you can go from dishwasher to owner to CEO, there's very few industries left in America where you're allowed to do that. That path does not exist. And so, but you know, showing them that we do care, I think you're spot on. We're hearing more and more, especially with the young people. Karen, anything to add on this point?
Yeah, just a couple of thoughts that Amy got, just since I think Megan and Amy answered the question beautifully about what's happening within our own restaurants. But look, I think as an industry, we've got a self-induced PR problem, you know, and I think when I think about it on a bigger scale, you know, the first thing I'll say that makes me cringe is when I see a restaurant operator on television talking exactly what you were talking about, Emily. Do we think it's these extended unemployment benefits? I'm like, I am so grateful that there were payments to help our people out. And you know what? If they got a little bit more, then that's fabulous.
That's right.
Look, we are sometimes America's training ground in the restaurant industry, right? So we know that we are in a relatively low margin business. I think there's been a lot of studies on our, you know, profit per employee is relatively low compared to, you know, other industries. But I still can't think of a better industry out there. But I think when we have our restaurant, you know, some restaurant leaders out there talking about, you know, oh my gosh, we've got to stop these unemployment benefits and, you know, we've got to cut them off early. And at the same time, they're calling the government asking for PPP loans and the RRF, you know, funding. I think that's not good for us, you know? And so, and I think there's opportunity to serve both. And so I do hope that we do stop saying that a little bit. But I also think about, look, I started as an hourly employee in the industry, as I think all of us on this call have. So we know what it's like. I think it's super fun to work in a restaurant. But as I think about today's environment and the busy schedules that people have, we have a job where you bring in all of these productivity companies who manage you down to the, you know, you probably don't have time to take like an extra breath. And I always say when we bring in these, you know, these gurus to say, be careful what you wish for. You are going to take all of the fun out of the job, yes. Right? You think about people working in the office. Oh, I can walk by and I can say hi to Meg or Amy, but not in the restaurant. You have zero downtime. And I think we have to think about that as an industry to bring the fun back into the work. And we have to find a way to just to, you know, whether it's how the pricing is ultimately going to work, have predictable schedules. So I don't have to figure out how to manage my family. Oh, by the way, it's Thursday and I don't even know what my schedule is next week, right? We have to change those things. So I think we have to look internally and do a better job ourselves. But at the core of what we have here, it's an amazing industry and a lot of fun and a lot of great life skills. We're not going away. We're just going to get better.
Yeah, I think it's such an opportunity and the operators that are willing to have and have the courage, right, to look inward and think about what can be done differently. You know, for me personally, I'm just laser focused on this female issue. We still have about 1.5 million women that were working in March of 20 that are not back. They can't be because schools are unpredictable. 3 weeks ago, 40% of our schools were open in this country. Childcare is unaffordable. If you're paying an hourly rate that exceeds what you're making, that math doesn't work for people. And so for our industry, I think what we relied on is the services and support for our workforce are probably even more significant than we imagined before. And I think you'll see the state restaurant associations and in Texas, I can give a good example where the Workforce Commission took hundreds of millions out of the American Rescue Package dollars to shore up childcare, because it's not just our sector, it's any sector working remotely. And that needs to get back in front of a customer is really hamstrung. And so we've got to figure that out, because we are predominantly women in our sector. And so with that being, you know, the makeup of our industry, we've got to understand how to provide those support systems outside. And I look at the loss. They're predicting it's 7 years of gains for women from the pandemic lost, just because of the responsibilities they took on. So I think that's also a piece of this equation that feeds into the overall complexity of workforce. But I agree with all three of you. I think it's an incredible place to be. And I love Karen's comment, bring the fun back. We all got attracted here, because I remember working for Marriott and being out late and doing weddings, and I didn't even know what I was doing back then, but I loved it, you know, and I still am in touch with some of these brides. And so that part of what makes people want to come and be part of our family, we've got to reimagine when we get out of my next question, which is really around labor is one piece of this, but supply chain. I think we learned how fragile the supply chain is and how difficult it is for grocery and restaurant to work together, all the way back to manufacturing, packaging, and so on. We're hearing a lot more about pricing of everything that goes into what you make, accelerating at a rate that's almost unsustainable. I just had an operator today say he was paying $2.49 a pound for skirt steak a year ago. Now it's $12.49. At some point, you know, NRA's predicted menu costs will exceed the highest they have since 2008. Talk to me a little bit about that, because I think labor, supply chain, and everything you use to make all coming at once is just like another storm that you're all trying to navigate. And so I don't know who wants to start with the sort of the supply chain, and maybe what, if you do have an answer to what you're dealing with, and Meg's like me first.
Well, I don't think there's an answer. No. I will say that, our supply chain department is earning their pay right now. And I've never heard more, and maybe don't want to hear more about commodities and pigs and China. And I mean, unfortunately, over the last year, went from one major distributor with six different DCs to now I think we have 23 different distribution companies that we're working with. So, hello.
Wow.
So that's been very challenging. So, you know, I know they're doing the best they can with moving around product. We've had to talk more and more with our franchisees on trying to stock up and make sure that they're carrying a little bit more of a buffer than they might, to be a little bit more compassionate on what's going on with the distribution centers, you know, when they have the drivers that don't show up, whatever it might be. We even had one weekend with one of our DCs where we had some of my staff. We had two refrigerated trucks parked at the DC so that my guys were going to drive and do supplementary runs. Wow. But it was, you know, sometimes you've got to do whatever you can to support the franchisees, and that was part of it. So there is no answer. You hope that the federal government does more and more to try and get folks into that capable of driving at an earlier age. I think it's still 21. So there is that gap of folks who leave school at 18 and probably would be great for the job, but legally can't do it until they're 21. So I think more they can do and get earlier apprentice programs to get some more folks into that. And I think the DCs are going to have to be a lot more creative with what they're doing, with whether it's dropping off trailers, whatever it might be. But we have to get smarter in, again, having some extra product, being a little bit more flexible. There is no saving grace. The only thing that's helping us from a pricing point of view is, fortunately, or unfortunately, in this particular instance, the consumer is seeing every price go up wherever they are.
Everything.
So whether it's grocery prices or they order a piece of furniture and it takes 8 months because they can't get whatever it is, or they're building a new house and they can't get a contractor or the wood. And so at least this situation, we've had others in the past where I've seen restaurants take restaurant prices or menu prices, and the consumer hasn't seen anything to correlate with that, so don't quite understand it. I think we're not in that boat right now. I think they see it everywhere. Now, what that does to disposable income is a whole different story. So there is no solution other than we've got to do the best to get through it.
And creativity, right? As you said, very creative. Amy or Karen, anything to add on this supply chain challenge?
Yeah, look, I mean, we're in four states, and you would never start a brand this way by being so spread out, but we are. So, you know, navigating the supply chain has been absolutely incredible. I will say, you know, our partners from the distribution warehouses have been wonderful trying to make it work. But look, they're having the same challenges we are. Worker shortages, people working from home, driver shortages, you know, and for them getting supplies into, it just goes all the way down the chain, right? So I think it's be patient with one another. And, you know, I think guests are starting to understand if you don't have something, and we've had to 86 it, you know, you hear the stories about some of the rogue guests who are a little out of hand. We've all dealt with them. But for the most part, 99% of the guests walk in are beautiful, wonderful, and totally understand what we're going through. And for that, we're grateful. So, but it's I think we've got another 6 months of this before things start to settle down.
I think you're right. I think 6 months is fair. And I did a talk last week to the media around chicken, because chicken prices, right? Chicken wings in particular. And I found myself saying, reminding them that the chicken only has two wings and that chicken production was down 4% for the start of the year. And by the time I was finished, she said, "Boy, Dr. Knight, you know a lot about chicken." And I'm like, "Yeah, that's kind of weird. Like, who would have known how long it takes to cook a chicken, or I guess raise a chicken?" But the point was, it sort of comes downstream and you realize that they also don't have the poultry workers in the manufacturing plants to actually get the chickens through the system. And then what that does on the other end, when everybody wants chicken wings, the price has gone up astronomically, right? So now we have wings and thighs as a way, and that's some of that innovation, right? That you wouldn't have imagined a year ago. Let's talk technology. To me, if I think about our, go ahead.
I was just gonna say, this is probably where I throw in the plant-based plug, because—
Yeah, there you go.
There's some great chicken products out there that you would not be able to tell the difference.
You know, Karen, I'm going to try it. You got to come to Texas.
Okay, sounds good.
Yeah, you're right. You should be killing it. So technology, if I think, and I'm putting my independent operator hat on right now, right? And so this has been one of the biggest things to hit independent operators alone, is that many times they weren't invested in technology at the, you know, delivery technology, website, Google. Talking with some of the Google restaurant folks, more than 70% of restaurants weren't even populated correctly on Google for search when you went to hours, website, menu, et cetera, prior to the pandemic. And that gap has been closed tremendously. As we think about technology and how it's hit this sector, what are the things that you think are here to stay? You know, what innovation, from contactless to the way people order to how you manage your staff, sort of what are those systems that you all are thinking about that are going to be kind of game changers going forward for either the consumer or your employees? I'm not sure if Amy wants to take that first.
Well, Sweetgreen was a little bit ahead of the game, I must say, when it came to technology and being set up for something like this to happen. We have native and marketplace delivery. And so we were kind of, you know, we were doing really well when the pandemic hit. But I also think we were doing really well because healthy food had never been so important when the pandemic hit. So I think Karen kind of felt some of that too. And I'm sure Meg, as far as, you know, having chicken problems, Karen, like all the rest of us. So, but the healthy food, and then also just getting set up for delivery. Some of our restaurants have one line, up to three or four or five lines that you see behind the scenes. And so our Olo presence was really there. And all we did was really kind of push a lot of ordering through our app. And I think our company has invested very well in that, where, you know, I think we're still investing. There's some things that we're working on now that will help us even further down the line. And so that's really exciting. But it's, you know, it really is the third party delivery. You know, they own us. They own, I think, all of us right now. And I do think that as it is here right now, but I do think that's also going to evolve, because everybody can't pay 30, 20% margin off, you know, off of one delivery order all day long. So there's a lot of work to be done there, I think. And I think that that's going to be a huge innovation piece in our industry. It'll be interesting to see what happens with DoorDash and some of these other companies. Mm-hmm. Because I think we're starting to fight back a little bit that we can't— Yes. we can't all have that and really survive. But as far as, you know, the innovation goes, it's continuing. It's every day. We're talking about what Karen's talking about, labor productivity, and you know, how do we do things differently? And so it's going to be interesting what the future holds. So we're working on some stuff, and I'm excited to share in the near future.
Excellent. Good. Meg or Karen?
Well, I think what I would say, you know, I think from the guest perspective, first of all, I'm wondering if we'll ever see a cashier in a quick service or limited service restaurant in 5 years, right? I really think that's going to start to change. And what this did was get a lot of folks who had never, you know, the pandemic, people who had never used technology to place an order, learned how to do that.
Yes.
And I think it's interesting as we're coming out of it, the incremental business that we're seeing is dying in. But so far, though, that off-premise business has stayed fairly steady.
That's right.
So it's going to be interesting to see how it recovers. Now, keep in mind, we have a more urban-based company, and I think the winners in the pandemic, if you can say that there's winners, were drive-thru and suburban. We weren't either. So that can be a little bit tough, but to like Amy's point, because we were urban, we had already invested in some of the technology platforms. So we'd already been opportunistic and had the third party platforms. I do think one of the challenges that we've had throughout this, and maybe it's because I'm a small company now, where I'm used to being a bigger company where you might've had a little bit more, opportunity to get a hold of the right people in certain companies, your ability to get projects done in the technology companies, they too are swamped, and to get, you know, simple things and changes made, there's a much longer lead time than we are. But look, I think everything's seamless. You know, I think the guests are going to continue to be comfortable ordering on your phone. So anything we can do to make, and this was 10 years ago, we've been talking about this seamless, frictionless experience from the minute the guest thinks about you to the time they get the food, that's all going to stay. But I do think more and more is going to shift to the consumer, especially at the order entry point.
Yeah.
And then the other thing that I would mention too is data. I think data is becoming more and more important to us to target these guests. As we know now, I think what at least 85% of the contacts to our business come from the mobile phone. We've got to be where they are. We've got to be able to talk to them better. So I think those of us that are smart about data, but just mining it and getting the right insights, are going to be the real winners going forward too.
Great comments.
Karen brings up a great point on, our companies or our individual restaurants, whether we laid people off but it's also going to the support companies that also did. So where we think, okay, we're ready to reopen, so everybody else must be, well, the NCRs and the help desks of the world, they furloughed off a lot of people.
That's right.
So now to get them back, or any distributor, anybody who's making anything, that sales went down. So I think there are a lot of restaurants or people that go, hey, I'm ready to open, so everybody must be ready to accept me with open arms. And that's not always the case. I mean, as much as they would want to, the labor affects that too. From a technology point of view, we were very fortunate in that we had had a lot of we were either working on new platforms. We just rolled out a new customized online ordering platform that we've been working on, but we had our old one worked wonderfully at the time. We had already really talked to all of our franchisees and really got them into doing third party. What we were in the process of rolling out was an aggregator. So instead our goal was to get all the tablets off the counter. We were able to do that even during the pandemic. So what became a much bigger channel of trade, we were now better able, the restaurants were better able to handle the chips were coming in through the register rather than again on the tablet or email, whatever it might be. We're still refining some things. We're not at the kiosk yet. We've been doing a lot of conversations about that. But I think that, you know, going back to the third party, if there was any restaurant who wasn't involved in it prior and then tried to jump on the bandwagon, well, that was, you know, you could still be on a waiting list to this day. They're also overburdened. So technology will continue to be a big part of everything we do. Going back, is it, you know, are people ordering on the mobile? Is it on the website? How do we really maximize their experiences? How can we do the contactless? Curbside, we started working on doing a curbside option, and then certainly drive-through. Now we've probably up to about 75 drive-throughs, and they were kicking some sales through during the pandemic. I mean, it was, you know, best of both worlds. So we'll again continue to work on those. We also, in the middle of the pandemic, rolled out a new POS system.
Karen and I are giggling. We're like, oh boy.
They were awesome though. You think we were really shocked. We thought maybe we could get 400 done by last December. And we were, I think, closer to 800 or 900, and we now have, I think, 7 restaurants left to roll out. So we were very excited.
Wow.
Congrats. So I got
one side, like, well, we might as well do it while we're got a few fewer guests coming in. But technology, I think, will always help to enhance the restaurant experience. And it's just figuring out what's going to stick. So,
yep. And I think it's taking those best practices. I mean, I try to akin it to when I was in higher education and the first online program was launched, and selling that to universities and being told that's just a fad. It's not here to stay. 15 years later, all the small colleges closing, right? Never adapted. And so in a way, we try to tell operators, this is a time to embrace something that you may have been putting off. Last Friday, I spoke at the Ghost Kitchen Conference, the first Ghost Kitchen Conference. It was extraordinary. Robots roaming around, feeding people. Data was the topic of conversation, right? Which was big data and how do restaurant operators become better users of data, not only collectors, but to actually drive decisions. But it was like being 15 years ago in higher ed again. And so watching these operators' eyes sort of open and realizing that the consumer has changed. You all said it, right? They want to pick up this phone and they want to have the menu accurate and it's easy. And they know if they hit a button, they're going to get it. And then I would just add on a third party delivery. Amy, you're spot on, right? This is a place that's evolving. And I know that to me, there's both a business shakeout that's going to happen, but there's also policy that needs to be put in place. And so, you know, Texas, we passed a delivery bill that gives protections to restaurants. It's probably not a state that has fee caps as an opportunity. But in general, that's going to have to follow along with this, is we're going to have to work on the ground in these states to be sure that restaurants, their brands, their trademarks, and what they do and how they operate are protected. And so I think that's when you see those two go hand in hand, and you're spot on. It's new, but I don't, even at a volume that, you know, some of these operators will never have, if they did, they still couldn't be successful at some of these rates. And so we're with you in that fight for sure.
One other comment on technology that I think we've started enhancing even more is using it when it comes to training. So mm-hmm. really getting away from, okay, I've got to have this person in front of me. Like we would make our general managers travel, or we would go out to travel and train in front of them, and really going, okay, we've got all this technology we can use now, whether it's the Zoom screens and the green screens and the this and or the virtual modules they can go in and do. And really had to let go of a lot of the old school. And that's really been very helpful. One, from a cost point of view for our franchisees, two, getting more information out in front of people quicker and at a wider expanse. So that's been a really cool thing to do, is just how can we make this work for us as well? So
that's great. Yeah, and engaging the employees, that's how they like to learn. And so new employees, and as you said, getting information to them quickly. And then as these, you know, mask police and other roles are having to play right now start to hopefully move away, right? You won't have all that disruption for them as well, which I know we're all looking forward to. Let's transition just a little bit into each of you have played an incredible role in your careers mentoring, right? Other, either women or other emerging leaders. And I know just by your backgrounds is something that's really important to you. And I specifically, Karen and Amy, I know are involved in two different sort of, I call them initiatives or projects, but frankly, they're really taking off and they involve mentoring and they involve sort of helping us when you look at, and I wish I had the screen here, you know, as the underrepresented population, or it's just focused on women and minorities in the first or line level jobs, right, are well represented. But very similarly, I think, to most industries, as you start to climb that ladder to CEO, that number gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And it's very alarming, because I remember as a young girl with my mom thinking, my mom thought that would never be the case for me, you know, 40 something years later, here we are. And so can you maybe share a little bit about both of these initiatives and you know, two things. One, I know why you started them and why you're part of them, but sort of what is it that they're doing and the difference they're making? And then maybe for people listening, either now or later, how can maybe they get involved? Because I think from what I can tell, it's really the village of this sector coming together, right, to help solve this problem, which is when I really think good things happen. And so, Amy, do you want to start? And then we'll jump to Karen.
Sure. So we have a a group of leaders that came together and we had a discussion. I was on the phone, I think, having wine with Karen one night, and we were discussing how expensive it is for young leaders to go to conferences and that they couldn't afford it. And what could we do to really impact this? And how do they get access to C-suite folks and show that it's possible for them to climb the ladder and have mentors or advocates? And so we put together a group of folks. We've got, you know, like Michael Bookmeyer, who's the COO and CPO at Red Robin, and Karen Stutz, and Robin Robeson from Lemonade and Mud Market, and just a lot of caring individuals like you alluded to, Emily, that want to see this industry thrive and help others along. So we have a mission. It's to develop and recognize and elevate emerging leaders in the industry. Ours is kind of similar to Karen, but we have conferences that people can afford. So pre-pandemic, we had three different ones around the country, and we had different speakers, and we charged $25 for a ticket. Wow. And we had prizes and things like that. And we had a really good turnout, and young leaders, they soak it up. And, you know, yeah. Karen spoke on one, we had panels on the others, male, female, DEI inclusive, you know, we made sure they were inclusive. And it's just really talking to them about the possibilities in the industry and how to, you know, build a great development plan and build great connections. We have happy hour after. And so it's just to get, you know, them knowing, getting each other in the industry and just meeting together. And so we stay in contact with them. We're getting ready to tour again. We'll be hitting Denver and Austin for the first two cities. Yay. This year. So we're excited about that. We'd love to have you come speak, plug.
Yes.
It's just really cool that, you know, we have these great things like Women's Food Service Forum, but it's $1,500 or $5,000 by the time you go. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of smaller organizations now in the industry that, you know, you can't sponsor a lot of folks to do something like that at the time, in times, especially now. So we're just trying to make affordable education and connection and mentoring with leads. So thanks for asking. And hopefully we'll be releasing the dates to those soon. We have a meeting coming up, and we've got some emerging leaders that are even on our board and council. So it's exciting to see.
That's awesome. No, I love it. And I was looking at some of the information. It's just a great group of people, right, that can make a real difference. And I always say, especially young women, we just want to look up and see someone who looks like us. Right. And if we can go to a conference and have that exposure and that person is normal and they're, you know, I always say there's no balance, it's blend, you know, I throw it all together and hope that I have a good day. I think that that is so important, especially right now as we're trying to attract people. Karen, I love the mission, mentoring, and you have very clear visions with Gleam to go global. And as you know, my background is very global, and I used to run a leadership group of women in about 17 different countries. And always felt grateful when I would finish my monthly calls because I saw the opportunity we had in the US. It's not perfect, but so much greater than so many parts of the world. And so tell us a little bit about this. You've got another great group of advisors and advisory board members, but share just a little bit with our audience today.
Yeah, I'd love to. Thank you for that opportunity. You know, as I talked about how long I've been in the business and the industry. Now Greg Flynn always used to say, I was in my learning years and now I'm in my earning years. And so for me, it was my learning years and my earning years. And I say, these are my give back years right now.
Oh, nice.
So if we were thinking about, you know, honestly, I had talked with Lo Mitchell-Brown, you guys, you know, Lo with the National Restaurant Association. And she keeps us all engaged. You know, and there's something about a big organization, you have to find ways to keep people engaged. And one of the things we were talking about one time, how do women feel as being part of the National Restaurant Association? So we had pitched something to, at that time, Dawn Sweeney, although she was on her way out and said, you're gonna have to move that on to the next year, which is Tom Bonet, and we love Tom. Mm-hmm. And then Lo was actually talking to Sanjeev Razdan, who also had a similar idea about mentoring. He and Amy had worked together, and I think he saw the impact also of LEAD and had a little downtime and thought, you know, I've got to give back the same way. I've got to do something. So Lo connected the two of us, and we started talking about the ideas. And then Sanjeev, you know, posted something on LinkedIn, and the need is so great. I will simply say that. So we birthed this thing called Gleam. It's Global Leadership Enhancement and Mentorship Network. It's easier just to say Gleam. And you can find us at gleamnetwork.net. We're a nonprofit, 100% volunteer. In this past year, we've already paired over 300 mentor-mentee groups. It's amazing. And, you know, we had a call with one of the groups, and I literally was trying not to cry listening to three of the mentees speak. One of them had made a comment, something like, you know, 8 weeks ago, I would never even be able to speak to all of you. And we always try to get them to come up with one big thing that they want to work on. So I'm mentoring someone right now, and we're working on the one big thing that they want to improve over the next 6 months, right? And they said, you know, I came off of this other one big thing, but what I got instead was confidence. Aww. You know, the other person said, I was this hourly employee, and I don't know if my company ever noticed me before, but my mentor helped me figure out how to have those conversations at work. And I have just been accepted into the management program. Oh. You know, you start hearing these programs. And if you just make a difference for one or two people, that's life-changing. And people get excited about being part of our industry, right? I said, before we have a PR problem, this is one way to solve it. We've got to tell our story. We have a great story and mentoring and giving back. So the generosity of all of the mentors and the mentees and our team, obviously Sanjeev, Sherry Mixa, Lo Mittelbron, Rohit from Kapoor from Starbucks. We just got so many wonderful people, and I left people out. I feel terrible. That are out there making a difference. We've got learning circles at the same time, and we're working on another program, which is a CAP program, and it's career acceleration or career advancement program. We're going to do a test pilot in July where we will work with hourly team members and teach them the soft skills. Like, how do you put a resume together? How do you talk to your manager about a career? You know, and those type of things that you don't necessarily get as an hourly employee, to make people understand how awesome our industry is. So we are just getting started. Registration is open for the fourth cohort. So go to gleamnetwork.net and sign up to be a mentor or a mentee. And I promise you will get back much more than you give.
I love it. And just the passion, as you and Amy spoke, right, is so clear. And I think this is when we as an industry come together to make a real difference, a needed difference. Well, you are amazing, all three of you, because we have about 3 minutes left. So this is perfect. I would love any last minute comments, anything else you want to say, or even, you know, what's the one thing that everyone needs to remember right now as we go forward? Any advice you want to give the group before we sign off?
Mine might be just simple. You know, obviously, we've all been through a lot of challenges right now, and we're thinking again, I kind of back to that heart of our business is our people right now. And if you've been an executive and in the industry and you haven't gone in and worked a shift for a while, I'll tell you, that is a really good way to go in and reset. Even if you say, you know, I did it 18 months ago before the pandemic, it's totally different. So go in there, get a feel for what your people are doing. It'll be very easy for you to make the right decisions quickly that absolutely support your team members. And again, it's up to us to make this, to be our own PR firm, so to speak, to make this industry look as attractive as possible. Getting in there, working side by side with your team members and hearing what they have to say and how we can be better, your answers are right there.
Excellent advice.
I'll just add to Karen's, I wear a hat sometimes in the restaurants, it's glitter, it says be kind. And I think with everything going on, I've had some crazy guests the teams handle, or the teams may have something going on at home and they may just need some place to vent or talk to. I think it's just really being kind. And at the same time, as sales are ramping up and businesses coming back, there's more accountability, right, coming back. So it's finding that balance. But at the end of the day, if you can just be kind on calls and seek to understand, it's so important right now. And it's probably not going to end for a couple of years. I think this is the industry is changing and we're a part of that. And we need to make sure we're making positive impacts.
And I would add, I love that, be kind. Reach out to people, whether, you know, if you think they're struggling or not struggling, or reach out for, you know, for yourself, for help, to talk, to vent. I mean, this is an incredible industry with a great network, and people like to be reached out to. Yes. So, you know, it's one of our biggest strengths. So let's not forget it. And you know, to Amy's point on, there's a lot of people struggling, and you could be that one, hey, you know, how are you doing? Are you okay? What can I do for you? That could make all the difference, whether it's an hourly employee or a peer. So.
And I'm plugging one more, assume positive intent.
Yeah, I always say assume innocence.
Everybody's getting busier and busier. And I'm like, hey, let's see what's going on with them and assume positive intent and not go down a crazy path of a thought, rather than let's just assume positive intent of that person. 99.9% of the time, if we did that all along, we'd be in a much better place moving faster.
Yep. Amy, I was going to say, we always say assume innocence, right? When you hear a story, and then grace just comes to mind for all of us right now, which is, you know, this is the one time in our history of our lives that the entire world underwent something so devastating, right? And how people have responded or reacted or been impacted is different. And you can't just assume if you can muscle through a situation that the person next to you can. And so just a little bit of grace, which I think is leaders, we all demonstrate. We just can't forget that as consumers too. When we go out, my daughters are always great when I'm like, what? And they're like, mom, I'm like, you're right. It's fine. It's okay. You know? And so it's just that reminding right now, and we will get through this. And I said this morning in an interview, I bet on restaurants and I always have. And I feel like we are going to come out of this and just, it's really going to be the revival, that we all believe it can be. So I want to thank the three of you so much for just the businesses that you run and the examples you set for all of us. You're just incredible leaders. And I'm really grateful for the time that you gave us and our audience today. So thank you so much.
Well, back at you, because
thank you, Emily.
You didn't allow us to let you talk about what you do, but thank you for your leadership. It's great.
Next time. And I'll have you all as ProStart judges in Texas. Yay! So don't worry. Thank you guys. Take care.
Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks, ladies.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.